This is the place to find yourself.
Istanbul offers great universities and the lifestyle is really amazing here.
So I live at the dorms at Maltepe University and I'm really happy with it. There's a cleaning service every few days and then there's the library nearby which is open 24/7.
My first impression when I came was like, it's huge. You have everything in one place.
When you first come to Maltepe University, you don't know where what is and you're like, oh my God, I need help. Guess what, you're not alone. There is the international office people over there. They're like family, they're very helpful and they're always there for you.
Istanbul is the perfect mixture between ancient and modern. Coming into this city helps me discover myself, learn about so many different cultures, learning about the world, which will help me in writing future books.
At Maltepe University, we have a lot of research centers. Because of that, we have the ability to participate in a lot of international projects.
Here at Maltepe University, the education consists of both practical and theoretical. We get the opportunity to practice everything we learn in class in real life. So after we graduate, we have a degree and we can work all over the world.
People come to Istanbul all the time, but what they really miss when they visit are the antique shops, which contain thousands of years of memories and also a thread of the modern future.
I like to use every minute and just get out and hop on the ferry and just go from the Asian side to the European side and just enjoy the wonderful weather with the wonderful Bosphorus behind me and just enjoying the moment of Istanbul.
Istanbul is very beautiful with great culture.
This city is the symbol of diversity. Come and study at Maltepe University.
Come here and feel like you're home.
Welcome to the first session again. The session subject is nursing care in COVID-19. Now I invite dear Tatsiona to join us from Greece. Talk about the cancer patient during COVID-19 pandemic. Now I'm calling upon you to speak.
Should I start?
Yes, start.
Okay. Good morning to everyone, and thank you very much for the opportunity to present at the International Student Conference, even from a distance, on a very topical issue, the COVID pandemic. My name is Ioanna Tatsi, and I'm a third-year nursing student. This study was done with my classmate, Georgia Luca. First of all, let me introduce you my school. I study at the International Hellenic University in the School of Health Sciences in the Department of Nursing. It is one of the five departments of the School of Health Sciences of the International University of Greece. The facilities of the department are located in Syndos, Thessaloniki. It operated for the first time in 1973. More than 4,000 students have graduated to date. Provides a four-year university degree. Here are some photos of the university. Let's talk about the pandemic period. During the pandemic, all courses were distance learning of modern and asynchronous education, but without clinical exercises. We hope to return very soon to our old rhythms and make up for what we have lost, especially in the practical part. Let's start with our travel. We start with the import, the purpose of study, then with the methodology, the results, then with the discussion with the suggestions, and we close with the conclusions. We choose to deal with the following thematic unit. Cancer patients delayed to definitive surgical treatment during COVID-19 pandemic.
Your presentation is not working, please. Click on full screen.
I couldn't hear you.
Presentation is not pressing click. Click on the full screen. Push the screen.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
What is the problem?
Presentation is not progressing, please. Presentation is not progressing. Click on the full screen.
Full screen. Yes, this is full screen to me. It's the full screen. I put in the full screen.
We can't see you. We can't see your presentation.
Why? Now?
Now.
No.
Hayır. No.
From the start, from the beginning, nothing at all. Should I start again from the beginning? No? Now can you see it?
Yes, I can see you, but presentation is not progressing.
You can see the presentation. What is the problem?
Click on the full screen. Yani you need the full screen. Click on the full screen.
Now?
No.
No? Why?
Start the presentation.
No, no, no. I don't know why. Because from my laptop, it's in the full screen. Now, can you see it?
No.
No.
This is the place to find yourself. Istanbul offers great universities and the lifestyle is really amazing here.
So I live at the dorms at Maltepe University and I'm really happy with it. There's a cleaning service every few days and then there's the library nearby which is open 24/7.
My first impression when I came was like, it's huge. You have everything in one place.
When you first come to Maltepe University, you don't know where what is and you're like, oh my God, I need help. Guess what, you're not alone. There is the international office people over there. They're like family. They're very helpful and they're always there for you. Istanbul is the perfect mixture between ancient and modern. Coming into this city helps me discover myself, learn about so many different cultures, learning about the world, which will help me in writing future books.
At Maltepe University, we have a lot of research centers. Because of that, we have the ability to participate in a lot of international projects.
Here at Maltepe University, the education consists of both practical and theoretical. We get the opportunity to practice everything we learn in class in real life. So after we graduate, we have a degree and we can work all over the world.
People come to Istanbul all the time, but what they really miss when they visit are the antique shops, which contain thousands of years of memories and also a thread of the modern future.
I like to use every minute and just get out and hop on the ferry and just go from the Asian side to the European side and just enjoy the wonderful weather with the wonderful Bosphorus behind me and just enjoying the moment of Istanbul.
Istanbul is very beautiful with great culture.
This city is the symbol of diversity. Come and study at Maltepe University.
Come here and feel like you're home.
We had a technical problem, we apologize. Now I invite their PhD students who are joining us from Turkey to talk about the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic on the treatment and care process of gynecological cancers. Now I'm calling upon you to speak.
Is it okay? Is it okay?
Yes, okay.
Hello, everyone. I'm Tuba Öz. I'm a student of Marmara University Obstetric and Gynecologic Nursing and Nursing PhD program. We prepared this study with my friend Rüveyda Ölmez Yalazı and our advisor Nurdan Demirci. The effect of COVID-19 pandemic on the treatment and care process of gynecologic cancer. Marmara University started education in 1883. Marmara University is one of the most established educational institution in our country. Nursing department, it is one of the nursing departments that educate active students among the state university in Istanbul. Teaching employees are competent and experienced in their fields, and our graduation preferred in the field. Qualified in 9 different departments, there are postgraduate education opportunities as well as education. Presentation plan, subject and purpose of the study, materials and method, results, conclusion, reference. Keywords, COVID-19, pandemic, gynecologic cancer, nursing. Subject and purpose of the study, COVID-19 virus, which is included in the beta coronavirus family, including SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV emergent in Wuhan, China in December 2018-19 and rapidly affected the whole world in a short time. It was declared as a pandemic in March 2020. According to the data of the American Cancer Association, 1,735,350 cancer cases and 110,070 gynecologic cancers case developed in 2018, and approximately 32,120 women died due to the gynecologic cancer. Gynecologic cancer, cervix, endometrium, ovarian cancers, which are among the top 10 most common cancers among women in our country. Studies have reported that individuals diagnosed with cancer have a higher risk of getting COVID-19 than those without cancer. With this justification, it has been argued that personal protection measures should be applied in the strong way in cancer patients who are undergoing cancer treatment or under follow-up. During the pandemic process, it has been suggested that cancer surgery, even adjuvant chemotherapy, be delayed deliberately, according to some, postponing surgery for 3 or 8 weeks is a reasonable approach in selected gynecologic cancer cases. It shouldn't be forgotten that postponement of oncologic surgery may result in disease progression, tumor non-resectable, and poorer survival outcome. With this justification, if surgery is delayed, it would be better to evaluate the case every 2 or 4 weeks. During the pandemic, it was decided not to be operated on case with no absolute surgical urgency, people with unknown COVID-19 status and those with flu-like symptoms and COVID-19 positive cases. It is thought that postponing surgery in cases with gynecologic cancer is not physiological, acceptable for the patient and their relatives. COVID-19 virus outbreak stress has been added to the cancer treatment process, which is physical and physiological challenge process. For these reasons, this study aimed to examine the effect of the COVID-19 pandemic on gynecologic cancers. Material method, the review was created through meta-analysis, systematic reviews, and randomized controlled trials on gynecologic cancer that were accessed through PubMed and Google Scholar and conducted during the COVID-19 process. Results, gynecologic cancer is defined as the uncontrolled growth and spread of abnormal cells seen in female reproductive organs, including cervix, ovary, uterus, fallopian tubes, vagina, and vulva. There are recommendations of international associations such as European Society of Gynecologic Oncology, Society of Gynecologic Oncology, International Gynecologic Cancer Society, and the American College of Surgeons. Recommendation recurring outpatient visits respects only new patients, consultation requiring acute oncologic evaluation, and patient ongoing active therapy. It should reduce exposure by reducing number of the people on the time as much as possible. Having essential staff for patient care should reduce the number of assistants and students. The number of patient attendants should be limited to one. If that one person is very necessary, do the patient's possible physical or physiological limitation, and care should be taken that this attendant doesn't have any suspicion of infection. Cancel of routine follow-up surveillance visits. If condition permit, counseling should be provided by telephone or internet. Web-based consultation should be put on the agenda if possible. Thus, a more appropriate, fast and healthy triage should be made possible. In patients who are asymptomatic and have no evidence of disease in evaluation, all procedures that are not entirely necessary should be postponed. Routine imaging, serum markers. Suggestion for disease management: while making the decision to postpone the operation, the question of how long it can be postponed is important. From a physiological point of view, there is no acceptable postponement period. In gynecologic cancer management, a study designing that will provide level one evidence for holding the surgery or performing it in a short time is not possible for understandable reasons. We have that data from retrospective studies. Science blood donation rates will decrease as a result of the pandemic. Attention should be paid to supply and availability of blood production. Healthcare workers should consider donation blood and, if possible, encourage their involvement. The elective surgery acute sale is used for possible operation that can be performed under the COVID-19 outbreak in the United States. Emergency situation, in the following situation, surgery is required with an emergency indication: stomach, intestinal obstruction, vaginal uterine or pelvic hemorrhage, molar pregnancy ya da intestinal obstruction. Endometrial cancer is the most common gynecologic cancer in America. By the American Cancer Society, according to 2021 forecast date, it has been reported that 66,570 new endometrial cancer will be diagnosed and approximately 12,940 deaths will develop. In our country, endometrial cancer is defined as the fourth most common cancer type in women. Recommendation for endometrial cancer: surgical treatment continues to be the gold standard for early stage endometrial cancer. Minimal invasive laparoscopic robot, assisted or unsupported route is the preferred option. In patients with preoperative low and moderate risk, bilateral adnexectomy association with the sensual node procedure and total hysterectomy should be preferred. Yine, for patients with high risk according to pelvic and lumbar aorting lymphadenectomy staging, comorbid, obesity, anticoagulant therapy, diabetes, and age should be considered. For advanced endometrial cancer, stage 3 or stage 4, first-line medical treatment should be applied. For a patient with postmenopausal metrology and endometrial taking on ultrasound, endometrial people sampling should be performed at the consultation. In the case of an adult diagnostic evaluation, the date of diagnostic hysteroscopy and biopsy curtage should be adjusted according to the degree of endometrial cancer suspicion and excess restriction to the operating room. Ovarian cancer: according to the date of the World Health Organization, 2020 ovarian cancer is reported as the third cancer type with the highest incidence and the second highest mortality among gynecologic cancer. In 2020, 313,959 new cases and 207,252 deaths were reported, according to 2021 forecast date of the American Cancer Association, it has been reported that 21,410 new ovarian cancer cases will be diagnosed and approximately 13,770 deaths will occur. In our country, ovarian cancer is defined as the seventh most common type of cancer in women. A recommendation for ovarian cancer. For advanced ovarian cancer that may require the use of postoperative resection for sterilization surgery, neoadjuvant chemotherapy should be the preferred option, even if primary sterilization surgery may be considered. During the COVID-19 pandemic period, patients shouldn't be recommended hyperthermic intraperitoneal chemotherapy. Cervical cancer. Cervical cancer is defined as one of the four cancers that must affect women of all age groups worldwide. Mortality due to cervical cancer decreases repeatedly after early diagnosis with Pap smear application. According to the 2021 forecast date of the American Cancer Society, it has been reported that approximately 14,418 invasive cervical cancer will be diagnosed and approximately 4,219 deaths will occur. Recommendation for cervical cancer, radiotherapy and concurrent radiotherapy should apply surgery as first-line treatment whenever possible. Lymph node stations operation should be revived on a case-by-case basis. Depending on the region, the result of imaging test and the disease stage, hysterectomy after concomitant radio chemotherapy is only indicated if a tumor result is detected after treatment. Conclusion and recommendation, the fact that women are diagnosed with cancer in any period of their life, undergo chemotherapy, radiotherapy, brachytherapy treatment, or even undergo surgical operation, and as a result, surgical menopause cases women to be adversely affected, change their body perceptions and deteriorate their sexual identity. It's true that the COVID-19 pandemic process negatively affects the treatment process of gynecologic patients. Care should be optimized to shorten the treatment process to prevent complication that may occur and to minimize the complication that develop. Women health nurses should be aware of the problems that women undergoing gynecologic cancer treatment might experience and should be able to provide individual, effective, quality and holistic care. Being aware of the fear and stress of the COVID-19 pandemic period, women's health nurses are required to provide supportive care to women undergoing gynecologic cancer treatment. Health professionals need to plan the treatment and care management of women diagnosed with gynecologic cancer in line with the national and international guideline published for the COVID-19 pandemic process. As a result, social distance and personal protection equipment are very important. Every patient with known COVID-19 symptoms should undergo universal screening, clinical visits, and pre-surgical evaluation. Telemedicine should focus on its resources. While ending my word, I congratulate May 12th World Nurses Day. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you to the research PhD student Tuba Öz for your assistance. Now I invite you to Yana from Greece, because we had a technical problem, so she will make her presentation again. She to talk about the cancer patients during COVID-19 pandemic. Now I'm calling upon you to speak.
Is it okay now? Can you see it?
Yes, it's okay. I can see you. Yes.
So I'm going to the next slide. Tell me if you can see it. Okay.
Okay.
Let's start again. Good morning to everyone, and thank you very much for the opportunity to present at the International Student Conference, even from a distance, on a very topical issue, the COVID pandemic. My name is Ioana Tatsi, and I'm a third-year nursing student. This study was done with my classmate, Georgie Luca. It's okay now?
Yes, okay.
Can you see? Okay. First of all, let me introduce you my school. I study at the International Hellenic University in the School of Health Sciences in the Department of Nursing. It is one of the five departments of the School of Health Sciences of the International University of Greece. The facilities of the department are located in Syndos, Thessaloniki. It operated for the first time in 1973. More than 4,000 students have graduated to date. Provides a four-year university degree. Here are some photos from our university. Let's talk about the pandemic period. During the pandemic, all courses were distance learning of modern and asynchronous education, but without clinical exercises. We hope to return very soon to our old rooms and make up for what we have lost, especially in the practical part. Let's start with our travel. We start with the import, then with the purpose of study, the methodology, the results, discussion with the suggestion, and then we close with the conclusion. We choose to deal with the following thematic unit. Cancer patients delayed to definitive surgical treatment during COVID-19 pandemic. Let's say a few words about COVID-19 occupying us for more than a year due to its global occurrence. It's an infection caused by the SARS-CoV-2 virus. First appeared in December 2019 in China and has since caused unprecedented disruption to the health system and even more great pressure. From the other side, we have the cancer patients, a unique patient categorization who need a special treatment, like surgery. For this reason, they are higher risk than the general population due to their underlying disease and immunosuppression. These kind of patients have adverse effects, like intensive care unit admission, respiratory support, intubation, or even death. So any delay in treatment can cause morbidity and mortality. The aim of this study is to assess the clinical outcome of cancer patients in need of surgery during the pandemic. In this travel, we conducted a wide literature review on Medline, PubMed, World of Science, like WHO COVID database, and Elsevier. We used keywords like COVID-19 pandemic, cancer patients surgery, elective cancer surgery, COVID-19, delayed, oncologic surgery, COVID-19. Let's look at the results of the review of the delay of surgeries in cancer patients. Any delay can cause new cancer cases or metastatic cancers with low life expectancy. The doctors, due to the pandemic, were forced to use alternative non-surgical therapies such as chemotherapy or radiotherapy. Even a six-month delay could lead to a five-year reduction in survival, to even more deaths. Also, tumors may be more advanced, and upstage cancers will be more costly to treat, like stay in intensive care unit or hospitalization. Specifically, for more aggressive cancers, such as colorectal cancer, pancreatic, and gastric cancers, even shorter delays, such as 3 months, have the worst outcomes. To emphasize the fact that most hospitals have discontinued elective surgery by performing only emergency surgery. For example, in Greece, 80% of elective surgery were cancelled. The constant pressure on hospitals and intensive care units has led to the deprioritization of clinical services. But cancer patients can be operated on safely by following all protection measures and following the appropriate protocols, so that both patients and health professionals remain safe. As mentioned earlier, cancer patients can be operated on safely. Based on this, I would like to present you to the England Clinical Guide for Managing Non-COVID Patients in Need of Acute Treatment. More specifically, it is a categorization for surgical treatment of cancer. It is an approach that has also been used by Turkish hospitals. As we can see, we have four priority levels from 1A to 3. Starting from the 1A level, which is the emergency level. At this level, patients must be operated on within 24 hours to save life. 1B, at this level, patients must be operated on within 72 hours, and this is the urgent level. Level 2, surgery within 4 weeks to save life or prevent progression of disease beyond operability. In priority 3 level, elective surgery can be delayed for 10 to 12 weeks with no predictive negative outcome. As we said before, cancer patients can safely operate it. Here is a plan of COVID minimal surgery key pathway. Starting from the entrance of the hospital, where the patients arrive, the tests and thermometry are performed and the medical history is taken. Of course, visitors are not allowed to enter. The patient is then taken to the preoperative holding, then to the operating rooms, then to the postoperative care unit, and depending on his condition, either to the intensive care unit or to a hospital ward. Finally, he gets discharged. However, in order for all of this to run smoothly and safely, both patients and health professionals must follow a specific protocol in order to reduce to a minimum the spread of in hospital. It will be good to have different corridors for the COVID patients from the rest so that the cancer patients do not come in contact with cases. There should also be wards that will categorize the patients who will enter according to their state of health. According to what was reported, any delay in surgical treatment can have negative consequences for cancer patients, such as metastasis or even death. Next is to create some ethical dilemmas and concerns, such as whether the SARS-CoV-2 virus increases health inequality. Questions arise such as which patients can be operated on and which can't. Who decides this? Here are some suggestions for this report. The guidelines should be updated. The triage system should be in place now with the pandemic so that cancer patients do not lag behind in their surgical treatment. Clean sites, COVID-19 free for cancer cases. Health professionals must be using a mask and gloves. Testing both health workers and patients. Avoid elevators and public corridors that may have been used by SARS-CoV-2 patients, positive patients. It is very significant that weekly multidisciplinary oncology meetings should continue. Do not forget how important it is to build COVID minimal surgery kit pathway to all hospitals, which is a pathway for everyone, including patients, staff, locations, and even visitors. Here are the four tables that summarize the key components to the COVID minimal pathway. Observance of measures, test on patients and entry based on triage system. Then test on staff and educate them on minimizing exposure to pathway patients. In addition, separation of wards and corridors for cancer patients not to come in contact with COVID patients. Last and most important, to explicitly prohibit entry to visitors. Finally, in our conclusions, we have to emphasize the following. Surgical treatment in cancer patients must continue during COVID. Better administration for a smoother hospital operation, equality in health, compliance with protocols and recommendations, continuous training staff and proper pathway for COVID and non-COVID areas. Thank you for your attention.
We expect the attendees who want to ask questions or make contributions to write us from the YouTube chat section. Thank you to dear Tansiyonna for your assistance. Now I invite dear Athena Frekadaki joining us strongly to talk about how COVID-19 affects the mental health of health workers and patients. Now I am calling upon you to speak.
Hello. Hello. Igunas. My name is Athena Fragedaki and I'm an undergraduate nurse student of the International Hellenic University. My study is about how COVID-19 affects the mental health of health workers and patients. Before I start my studies presentation, I would like to introduce you to my university. IHU was established on September 30th, 2005, but it started operating in 2008. Until 2019, IHU was Greece's first public university where programs were taught exclusively on English. IHU offers specialist postgraduate programs to international and Greek students who aim to further their careers abroad. Currently, around 53,000 students are attending the university and their degrees are recognized both by the Greek state and the European Union. Undergraduate students need to attend 4 years in order to complete their study and receive their diploma. President of the university is Dr. Athanasios Kaisis, while the president of our department, nursing, is Dr. Evgenia Minasidou. The introduction to my study. Coronavirus disease 2019 is caused by the novel severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2, SARS-CoV-2 virus strain. On December 31, 2019, China first reported a novel coronavirus disease. The Wuhan Municipal Health Care Commission, after studying a cluster of cases of pneumonia in Wuhan, discovered the new virus.
Hi, we can see your slides.
You can, I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
We can't see your slides. Please upload your presentation. We can't see your slides.
I'm from two devices, so maybe you didn't make me host for both of them. I have two devices.
Please, can you click share button?
Excuse me?
Can you click share button?
Yeah, I have two devices and I'm sharing in the first one.
Okay, please
Can you see my presentation?
Yes, yes. I can see.
Thank you. So let's start from the beginning.
Thank you. Yes, please.
My name is Asana Fragezaki, and I'm an undergraduate nurse student of the International Hellenic University. My study is about how COVID-19 affects the mental health of health workers and patients. Before I start my studies presentation, I would like to introduce my university to you. IHU was established on September 30th, 2005, but it started cooperating in 2008. Until 2019, IHU was Greece's first public university where programs were taught exclusively in English. IHU offers specialist postgraduate programs to international and Greek students who aim to further their careers abroad. Currently, around 53,000 students are attending the university, and their degrees are recognized both by the Greek state and the European Union. They need to attend 4 years in order to complete their study and receive their diplomas. President of the university is Dr. Athanasios Kaisis, while the president of our department, nursing, is Dr. Evgenia Minosidou. Here are some photos of the university, and here are some of the data. About my study.
This is the place to find yourself. Istanbul offers great universities and the lifestyle is really amazing here.
So I live at the dorms at Maltepe University and I'm really happy with it. There's a cleaning service every few days and then there's the library nearby which is open 24/7.
My first impression when I came was like, it's huge. You have everything in one place.
When you first come to Maltepe University, you don't know where what is and you're like, oh my God, I need help. Guess what? You're not alone. There is the international office people over there. They're like family. They're very helpful and they're always there for you. Istanbul is the perfect mixture between ancient and modern. Coming into this city helps me discover myself, learn about so many different cultures, learning about the world, which will help me in writing future books.
At Maltepe University, we have a lot of research centers. Because of that, we have the ability to participate in a lot of international projects.
Here at Maltepe University, the education consists of both practical and theoretical. We get the opportunity to practice everything we learn in class in real life. So after we graduate, we have a degree and we can work all over the world.
People come to Istanbul all the time, but what they really miss when they visit are the antique shops, which contain thousands of years of memories, and also a thread of the modern future.
I like to use every minute and just get out and hop on the ferry and just go from the Asian side to the European side and just enjoy the wonderful weather with the wonderful Bosphorus behind me and just enjoying the moment of Istanbul.
Istanbul is very beautiful with great culture.
This city is the symbol of diversity. Come and study at Maltepe University.
Come here and feel like you're home.
Is joining us from Turkey to discuss the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic on women's health. Now I'm calling upon it to speak.
Hi.
Hi.
Can you see my presentation?
Yes, I can see.
Yes. Good morning. Welcome to our presentation. My name is Ceyda Sugündüz. I am a PhD student in Marmara University Institute of Health Science, Obstetric and Gynecologic Nursing Department. We prepared our study title, The Effect of COVID-19 Pandemic on Women's Health, together with my friend, PhD student Hamide Arslan Taarruz and my mentor, Nurdan Demirci. My school, Marmara University is a state university. It is located in the province of Istanbul in Turkey. Four-year undergraduate thesis and non-thesis masters and doctoral education are provided in nursing department. During the pandemic process, distance education was started both graduate and undergraduate programs. Our exams were also online. Homework delivery was made in some courses. We are trying to get used to the new online system. In this study, we examined the effect of the COVID-19 pandemic on women's health. The COVID-19 pandemic is challenging health systems all over the world. Women carry serious health risk arising from their gender. Density in health systems primarily affects women. Access to healthcare become difficult during the pandemic. Financial resources decreased. This situation negatively affected women's health. Gender inequality has important implications for women's health. COVID-19 pandemic increases gender inequality. The impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on gender inequality. The caregiver role of the woman in the family is dominant. Women employ more in the health workforce and social services. Therefore, women are at risk of becoming infected with the virus. Women are less involved in this decision-making mechanisms during the pandemic period. This situation makes it difficult to meet women's health needs. In the pandemic, women face more economic problems. In the USA, Germany, and Singapore, women are more likely to have higher unemployment and working hours reduction. In the USA, the productivity of female academics compared to male academics has decreased 13.9%. Women take on more unpaid domestic work in addition to their paid work. During the COVID-19 pandemic, women in Germany were more worried about child care. In Spain, most of the households and child care burden in the quarantine fell to women. Violence against women increases during epidemics. School closures can cause girls to drop out of their education. This may lead to an increase in adolescents' marriages and pregnancies. the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic period on domestic violence. COVID-19 pandemic has negatively affected the domestic dynamics. During the pandemic period, an increase in domestic violence of up to 27% has been reported in America. Calls to helpline for domestic violence increased in Mexico. In Turkey, there was a 27.8% increase in violence against women. The effects of the COVID-19 pandemic period on sexual and reproductive health. It has become difficult to access contraceptive methods in the pandemic. 19% of married women who do not use any modern method could not access family planning services in India. 51% of single women stopped using a method in Italy. 15% of these women had an unwanted pregnancy. The COVID-19 pandemic has reduced the quality of sexual life of men and women. The desire to conceive has decreased, but the use of contraceptions has also decreased. Menstrual disturbances increased. The use of human papilloma virus vaccine has decreased in the USA. Insufficient healthcare can lead to miscarriage and an increase in maternal and infant mortality. The direct effect of the COVID-19 virus on the pregnant woman and her baby is not fully known. The effects of COVID-19 pandemic on women's mental health. In the pandemic, people experience more mental health problems, such as anxiety, depression, fear, and stress. According to studies done, during the COVID-19 pandemic process, women experience more severe problems, such as anxiety, post-traumatic stress disorder, and fear. Because in the pandemic, the burden of women has increased even more. It also works in a risk area for viruses. Benefiting of women from healthcare services during the COVID-19 pandemic period. A significant part of the budget and human resources of healthcare services has been allocated to combat the pandemic. Cancer screening decreased. Sharpless, the director of the National Cancer Institute, said there could be an increase in cancer deaths of 1% to 2% over the next 3 years. nurses' roles and responsibility in the effect of COVID-19 pandemic on women's health. The struggle of nurses in the pandemic was seen by the whole world. Core role of nurses come to the fore in the pandemic. Nurses should raise awareness of the public in preventing the pandemic. Nurses should provide psychological support to patients. Nurses should identify women's needs. Nurses must meet the needs of women. For example, in case of violence, helplines, shelters, telehealth should be explained. As a result in the COVID-19 pandemic process, gender inequality has increased. Access to healthcare facilities was adversely affected. Domestic violence has increased. The use of contraceptive method has decreased. The quality of sexual life has declined. Mental health problems such as depression, anxiety, and fear increased. Cancer screening decreased. These are my reference. Thank you for your attention.
We expect the attendees who want to ask questions or make contributions to write us from the YouTube chat section. Thank you to the research PhD student Sreda Sugundus for your contribution. Now I invite dear Athena Prekadaki again because we technical problems. So she talked about how COVID-19 affects the mental health of health workers and patients. Now I am calling upon you to speak.
This is the place to find yourself. Istanbul offers great universities and the lifestyle is really amazing here.
So I live at the dorms at Maltepe University and I'm really happy with it. There's a cleaning service every few days and then there's the library nearby which is open 24/7.
My first impression when I came was like, it's huge. You have everything in one place.
When you first come to multiple university, you don't know where what is and you're like, oh my God, I need help. Guess what? You're not alone. There is the international office people over there. They're like family. They're very helpful and they're always there for you.
Istanbul is the perfect mixture between ancient and modern. Coming into this city helps me discover myself, learn about so many different cultures, learning about the world, which will help me in writing future books.
At Maltepe University, we have a lot of research centers. Because of that, we have the ability to participate in a lot of international projects.
Here at Maltepe University, the education consists of both practical and theoretical. We get the opportunity to practice everything we learn in class in real life. So after we graduate, we have a degree and we can work all over the world.
People come to Istanbul all the time, but what they really miss when they visit are the antique shops, which contain thousands of years of memories and also a thread of the modern future.
I like to use every minute and just get out and hop on the ferry and just go from the Asian side to the European side and just enjoy the wonderful weather with the wonderful Bosphorus behind me and just enjoying the moment of Istanbul.
Istanbul is very beautiful with great culture.
This city is the symbol of diversity. Come and study at Maltepe University.
Come here and feel like you're home.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I've been back.
Who is the queen?
Can you see my presentation?
Yes, I can see you, but you can, yani you need click the full screen button.
Yes. Is it okay? I'm in the full screen. I don't know what's happening. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I will try to.
Again, click the full screen.
I will share again. I'm sorry. Is it okay? Is it on full screen?
Please continue. Start a presentation button above the screen.
Is it okay now?
Yes.
I'm clicking the button, but for some reason it doesn't go on full screen.
Start.
I'll try to start again.
Okay.
Is it okay?
Please start. Okay.
Should I start?
Yes, start please.
My name is Asna Fragedaki, and I'm an undergraduate nurse student of the International Hellenic University. My study is about how COVID-19 affects the mental health of health workers and patients. Before I start my study presentation, I would like to introduce you to my university to you. IHU was established on September 30th, 2005, but it started operating in 2008. Until 2019, IHU was Greece's first public university where programs were taught exclusively in English. IHU offers specialist postgraduate programs to international and Greek students who aim to further their careers abroad. Currently, around 53,000 students are attending the university, and their degrees are recognized both by the Greek state and the European Union. Undergraduate students need to attend 4 years in order to complete their study and receive their diplomas. President of the university is Dr. Athanasios Kaisis, while the president of our department, nursing, is Dr. Evgenia Minasidou. Here are some photos of our university. The introduction to my study. Coronavirus disease 2019 is caused by the novel severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2, SARS-CoV-2 virus strain. On December 31, 2019, China first reported a novel coronavirus disease. The Wuhan Municipal Healthcare Commission, after studying a cluster of cases of pneumonia in Wuhan, discovered the new virus. By January 13, 2020, cases of COVID-19 were first reported outside of China in Thailand. On March 11, 2020, the Health Organization declared a pandemic with over 120,000 cases and 43,000 deaths around the globe. Clinical manifestations suggest due to acute nature of the virus and the social distancing orders based on quarantine terms, patients and health workers deal with numerous emotional distress. Here are some data about the COVID disease, last updated on April 17, 2021. Studying the literature, SARS-CoV-2 virus constitutes a zoonotic virus that can be transmitted from animals such as bats to humans and was adapted to do so between humans via airborne droplets and aerosols. Subjects that are the most vulnerable to develop moderate symptoms of COVID-19 are frail elderly, especially male subjects with a previous history of diabetes, cancer, and other autoimmune diseases. However, COVID-19 has been found to impact all groups of people. Symptoms of SARS-CoV-2 include both pathological and neuropsychiatric on the individual. Pathological symptoms may cause atypical pneumonia with rapid respiratory deterioration, diarrhea, nausea, and vomiting, chest pain and heart failure, renal injury, headache, confusion. Neuropsychiatric and psychiatric symptoms linked to COVID-19 may be direct due to the virus itself or indirect caused by the restriction orders based on quarantine terms. Patients develop depression, anxiety, distress, insomnia, high risk of post-traumatic disorders, substance use, panic attacks triggered by fear of COVID-19. COVID-19 seems to also affect mental health of patients and health workers, but not necessarily because of the infection itself, but rather due to the social and psychological aspects of quarantine measurements or in constant care of COVID-19 patients. Psychological symptoms of health workers diverge between anxiety, depression, OCD, post-traumatic disorder, burnout, insomnia, substance use, and distress. Patients with pre-existing mental health disorders did not report higher scores on their symptoms. Surprisingly, their symptoms slightly decreased. Although professionals on the field are worried about their accessibility in mental health facilities and their proper treatment that may lack due to restricting orders. My study's aim is to examine how COVID-19 has affected the mental health of health workers plus patients and the causes of the emotional distress with regard to finding solutions that minimize the stress. Furthermore, the understanding of the underlying problems that are being highlighted during the pandemic caused by the lack of certain facilities in communities and the consequences that can be avoided in the future if appropriate preventive measures are applied. The study is a rapid scoping review focused on articles about the recent studies for mental health in health workers, COVID-19 patients, and people with pre-existing mental health conditions. The research was based on online published scientific data that were found by using Medline, PubMed, and Google Scholar's database for academic publication. The articles have been carefully examined to combine the information and statistical analysis to discuss the various problems that are caused due to coronavirus disease and the solutions that may occur or can be suggested. The results. Here are some bibliographic results and statistical analysis. We can clearly see that there is a need for longitudinal research, such as the psychological outcomes in mental health in health workers and psychological outcomes of patients with COVID-19. Studying the literature, some can realize the reasons behind the stress of health workers and COVID-19 patients. Concerning health workers, the reasons are sources of resources, tests, treatments, protection for infection, may cause ethical dilemma and fear for infection, fear of infecting loved ones, most important fear, and colleagues. Isolation from supporting environment, longer hours, communication with patients and their families, understaff. Studies made it clear that nurses among health professionals develop higher symptoms of mental disorders, such as depression, anxiety, insomnia, etc., together with burnout. There are conflicting opinions whether PTSD syndrome is present or not. In addition, some may argue that professionals with the most mental health burden could not participate based on their emotional exhaustion and workload. Factors that are linked to higher emotional distress rate are being a nurse, a female, young with little work experience, single, not having a child, working in frontline. Further discussion. In various researches, health workers tend to not seek for help, but prefer their own coping mechanisms, which do not seem to balance the stress. A lot of them lack the knowledge that support is available or assume it is limited and others need it more. Some of them are in denial that they need help, mostly because they're afraid of the stigma and claim they already have support networks. Worth mentioning are some that claiming they have no time seeking for help. Statistical analysis from the cross-sectional study show coping strategies in nursing. Avoidance. 36% avoiding working with COVID-19 patients, media, and same people in general. Avoidance is most common among the youngest staff. Problem solving. 75% nurses are following strict protective measures, learn more about COVID-19, social distancing. Male nurses found using less this method, while younger and single participants and ICU nurses scored higher. Transparency. 41.2% are practicing religious or spiritual activities, relaxation activities, relieve stress by chatting with their family. No participant mentioned psychological support as coping strategy. Regarding COVID-19 patients, it increases stress and can lead to the development of mental health conditions or a relapse of an already existing one, affecting positively in the mortality. Stress factors are the lack of effective therapy and understaffing, something that triggers health workers too. Psychological plus neurological problems may be due to COVID-19, affecting the brain by inducing a cytokine response and causes harm. Solutions suggested for both health professionals and patients. Further funding for understaffing problem will bring relief to both patients and health workers, being informed about the illness and risk. In-depth studies seeking about health professionals refusing to seek psychological support, providing information about the usual outcomes in this kind of stress, promoting coping strategies and linking patients to social and health services, counseling them to seek help, finding for resources such as protective equipment and treatment so health workers do not have to worry about their safety or being in a position for an ethical dilemma. Not enough evidence is presented about patients with pre-existing mental health conditions, and further investigation is needed due to conflict about their well-being being affected by coronavirus. The conclusion. Major necessity for longitudinal research to study the outcomes of emotional distress during a pandemic, solutions for stress in health workers and patients, plus more funding on equipment, research, and staff. Most research tend to be cross-sectional and are little to no evidence about long-term consequences of COVID-19 in the community. In addition, major emotional burden made it a priority for research to focus on solutions about the emotional distress SARS-CoV-2 developed both in health professionals and patients, nurses being the center of its effect. Care for revealing the stress is funding about equipment, develop a cure, mental health services, education for mental health stigma, and higher number of health workers in health facilities. Thank you for your time.
We expect the attendees who want to ask questions or make contributions to write us from the YouTube chat section. Thank you to dear Athena Pekadaki for your contributions. Yes, dear participants, we are taking a break from our program here. Looking forward to meeting you again at 11 a.m. Thank you.